Mi huriha umre ge mihum balang ekashi gen wagotan ufadda fawa programme.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Witness with Waheed has been away from you for a little bit of time, but then thank you once again for welcoming me and the program back into your living rooms and into your lives. Ladies and gentlemen, this program is all about awareness on your part as well as on mine. On this program, what we hope to do is to delve into certain complexities of life which can become very, very simple if you and I can give it just the right amount of thought. And to do that, I can't do it myself. You'll have to be part of the program. And also, I usually have a guest with me. And tonight, I have with me an old friend, somebody that you've met previously on this program, none other than Abu Amina Bilal Phillips. Now, before I bring him in front of you, as it were, allow me to tell you that during the course of tonight's program, we might be hitting upon a few subjects that some of you might consider delicate. Some of the questions that I ask my guest of this evening might go along the veins of what some people would call the devil's advocate. Please don't mind me doing that. It's all in good purpose, the good intention of making sure that we understand the topic that we're talking about. So do not permit me to waste your time anymore. Allow me to bring in my guest, my good old friend, Bilal.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the Maldives again, sir.
My pleasure to be back.
And brother, I have a topic for you this evening. Mm-hmm. And it goes like this. A good Muslim. Who makes a good Muslim? Perhaps before I can ask you any focused questions, could you give me a general idea of whom you consider a good Muslim would be?
A good Muslim would be one who lives his or her life in accordance with the teachings of Islam to the best of their ability. Not an angel, but not a devil.
Exactly.
Somewhere in between, trying to correct themselves when they make mistakes, learn from their mistakes, turn back to God in repentance, as Adam ate from the tree, you know, repented and was forgiven, rather than being like the devil, an arrogant, unrepentant, evil
human beings. Therefore, are fallible, and all we do is try, always try to be good. Is that the main focus?
Exactly. You know, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, "Ittaqullah mastata'tum." Fear Allah as much as you can,
and leave it up to His will.
Yeah. His mercy.
I was doing some reading on this topic just before I came to you, because when I have scholars like you, I have to do my homework. I was reading that one of the qualities of a good Muslim is truthfulness, the ability to always tell the truth. And I was reading this ayah in Surah An-Nisa, I think it was verse 135, something about always serving the cause of justice. Since I'm not a religious scholar, I'm not going to quote the ayah to you. What would you say about the necessity of truthfulness in being a good Muslim?
Well, truthfulness, if we listen to what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, you know, when he was asked about a believer, you know, would a believer commit adultery or fornication? Mm-hmm. Would they steal? Each time he said, they may do that. But when he came to the question, would they lie? He said, no.
They wouldn't.
So, I mean, what we're talking about here, so that truthfulness, that's just from the negative side. They wouldn't lie, meaning they would be truthful. But truthfulness in this context, we would say that It is truthfulness as a normal characteristic. Not that they never lie, because as human beings, times will come.
Is that, but
as
is
human
that, is
beings
that,
will lie. But
would that be truthfulness as part of justice? As stand firm in justice, even if it's against your parents or your relatives.
Yeah, this is part of truthfulness and trustworthiness, and you know, all of those related. But we should note that the Prophet Muhammad had said that there are three occasions in which a person is allowed to lie.
Enlighten me, please.
Well, those three are all geared towards fixing evil, where there's harm, potential harm, to prevent that potential harm from happening. The three examples that he gave was one between two Muslims who had fallen apart, were no longer friends, would no longer communicate with each other. So you, as the one who knows both of them, goes to one and says, you know, so-and-so wants to be your friend. He doesn't really want this to be that way. Though he didn't say that. And you go to the other one and say the same thing. Because, of course, when you say this, he might say, well, does he? Is that how he actually feels? Say, yes. He doesn't want the friendship to break up like this. So you are creating, you know, bringing Muslims together who had become separated due to factors which they should really be able to rise above. You know? So you create, you remind them really, are you reminding them, although they didn't say this, and you're saying that they said this, but really you're reminding them of the love and the good relationship that they had prior.
I see.
To try to bring it back again.
Right, that would be one circumstance.
One circumstance. The other circumstance the Prophet ﷺ mentioned was between a man and his wife, and it could be a husband, a wife and her husband, you know, that if a wife, for example, she sews an outfit and she comes in front of her husband in this outfit that she feels so good about, but he doesn't find it attractive. She says, what do you think? So you say, it looks great.
Sometimes in the interest of peace, you say, hey, that looks great.
Yes. To make her feel good, because for you to tell her, ah, that looks horrible. After she's gone through all this work and effort, you just, you know, just chopped her down, you know, you just
that makes sense
her.
To me, all in the name of peace, Islam.
Yes.
And the third?
The third, in the time of war. In the time of war, where war involves deception. You make the enemy think you're coming from the right, but you're actually coming from the left. And so you catch them. So this is, you know, deception that may take place. For example, you are caught as a prisoner, and they're torturing you, and they want you to give up the truth of where the rest of your battalion is. So you tell them they're over that side, but really they're over this side.
You lead me to this English saying that all is fair in love and war with the last two examples, but that's in lighter vein, sir.
Yeah.
That's in lighter vein, but I mean, in all seriousness, that actually works, doesn't it?
Yeah.
The next quality I seem to have noted down in my little notebook here is sincerity.
Sincerity, of course. This is, see, these are all relating back to faith. You know, as Allah stated in the Quran, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ
مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, yes. Exactly.
That's
exactly
what we're commanded to do. Not that we're going to be perfect angels, but that we make our religion sincere for Allah. It's sincere. Because if it's not sincere, if we're just doing the custom, the tradition, the outer appearances, then this is of no value. God doesn't need our worship. Our sincerity in worship changes us, makes us better people. You know. So that's so how does, you know, religion then transform the individual? Without sincerity, it's not possible.
So in the kind of homework that I was doing, in fact, I saw this in Surah Az-Zumar, Ayah 2, the exact same words that you quoted. And that really reassures me. How about being not selfish? The quality of unselfishness, as it were.
Well, you know, unselfishness, if we look at the other side of it, you're talking about generosity. You're giving, and the Prophet ﷺ had said, the truly generous, the best of people in generosity, is one who gives while he is healthy and desirous of that which he is giving.
Okay.
You know, surplus giving is a good thing, but that's easy to do. It's surplus.
Can I also put another spin on this? It's like these days, a lot of people seem to work on the idea of you scratch my back, I scratch yours. Is this lack of selfishness or is it something else?
No, you've got an agenda here. This is the hidden agenda. You know, I'm doing it for you, but know that you owe me a favor now. You owe me one.
Exactly. Right?
It's not a bad thing to do something to help others and expect them to do something to help you when you need it. It's a natural thing, you know.
Right.
But the selfless giving where you're not expecting anything back, that is the higher level.
That is a higher level. Exactly. Thank you so much. And then the next thing that I see is, you know, there are these people who always proclaim themselves to be so pure, so good, while all the others, everybody around, is bad. And this brings me to the subject of humility.
And of course, the Prophet ﷺ had said, whoever humbles himself for the sake of Allah, Allah will raise him up. You know, that this is the honor that is worth striving for. Not the honor which you have created for yourself through pride and the other, you know, forces that may drive you, desire for wealth and all these other kinds of things. But the real honor is the one where Allah has honored you in spite of your poverty or your beauty, lack of beauty, for example. You're not handsome, you're not whatever, which usually gives people airs, let them feel that they're better than, okay, no, you're not one of those either. But Allah lifts you up in the eyes of people because of your humility. And people do respect a humble person.
And God bless you. And God bless you for that. When I talk to you, sir, time tends to run out, and we will have to take a short break here. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back with you after a very, very small break. Thank you.
نامے سے خدمت تک معلومات فور ہم کما ایک فور کو دیوین فراتے کے یہی تیر کا ہود مت تیار تے پنچے الگن من کی سیول سروس
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Witness with Waheed. And the last thing we said was something about humility, as you would recall. The next thing I think perhaps I should ask our guest tonight is the value of patience. Since we've been waiting for the break.
Patience, of course, you know, the Prophet ﷺ had said that nobody has been given a greater blessing than patience. You know, to be given that by Allah naturally is a huge gift. And patience, he described as being in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself describes patience as being the key for paradise.
Oh.
He didn't use the word key for paradise as I just said it, but when he said that you will be tried in Surah Al-Baqarah, you'll be tried in your wealth, your family, in loss of life and loss of success and all these different things, give glad tidings to those who are patient.
I see.
Those who, whenever a calamity strikes them, say, we belong to Allah and to Him we must return.
Exactly. And all of us eventually do that.
Yes.
How about the...
But let me mention, before you go on to that, there's another point, because as we said, this was a great blessing from Allah that He gives to a few people. The rest of us have to work on it. So the Prophet ﷺ gave us the method, because to just leave us like that, now okay, now we don't have any chance for patience, only those who got it, if you didn't get it, you didn't have it. There's no way to have it.
Sometimes I have this problem myself, I just can't wait on certain things.
And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَمَنْ يَتَصَبَّرْ يُصَبِّرْهُمُ اللَّهِ. Whoever strives to be patient, externally, even though inside himself or herself they're exploding, they don't have, they're impatient, but that externally they have pretended to be patient, with striving to be patient,
and
then Allah will give them patience.
That pretense finally becomes reality.
Yes.
The next quality, sir, because we are limited for time here, and I know we can go on for hours. The qualities of a good Muslim also brings to, I think, as the ultimate virtue of a forgiving person. What do you say on that one?
Of course, we would have to say that this is one of the major attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which became manifest when Adam ate from the tree and sought his forgiveness, Adam and Eve. Because people ask commonly, why did Allah allow Satan to trick Adam?
Mm-hmm.
And
exactly.
He knew that Satan was going to trick him. If he allowed Satan to whisper to him about the tree, he would convince Adam and Adam would disobey him. Allah knew this before even the creation of Adam and Eve and Satan. So why? The point is that in that trickery of Satan, Adam's deception, being deceived and disobeying God, lay the chance for him to turn back to God in repentance, and God would forgive him. So through that repentance, God's attribute of infinite forgiveness is manifest. So that is, you know, we can say that is the characteristic unique to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and which human beings should seek to emulate when we reflect on the attributes of Allah, because people commonly get off into the 99 names of Allah, they just memorize the names, but they don't realize that these names have meanings. And these meanings are to be applied in our lives. It's not just merely learning 99 names, right? So this attribute is one of those that we can reflect. We strive to be forgiving. And the Prophet ﷺ had said, you know, whoever is not merciful and forgiving to others will not receive mercy and forgiveness from Allah.
You just touched on a very, very interesting topic here. The 99 names of God, if we can actually strive to emulate these 99 qualities of God by ourselves, we would become better human beings?
That's why he said that if you, whoever protects and guards those 99 will get paradise. But people think that the term for guarding, for man hafidhaha, whoever has memorized them, they've taken it from this perspective only, they will enter paradise. But surely, if a disbeliever, an atheist, memorizes the 99 names of Allah, he will get paradise?
He's going nowhere.
Exactly. You know, he's going somewhere, but not paradise.
Not that one.
So we know for sure that that is not what was intended. The hifth, the hafiz, this is protecting.
Protecting. Exactly.
How do we protect it? The scholars say we protect it by emulating it. Those that are relevant, that can be emulated, we should emulate. Those that are unique to Allah, then we should praise Him through them. Because of course there's some attributes like uluhiyah. We can't emulate that one. That is divinity. We don't seek to emulate that. That is going in the wrong direction.
Exactly.
But we recognize Allah's divinity and we worship Him and praise Him through that attribute.
Thank you for that insight, sir. Thank you so much. How about the concept of kindness to others?
This, of course, is something which the Prophet ﷺ spoke about when he described Muslims as being those who are respectful to our elders and kind to our young ones. These are mutually related attributes. Kindness, because in respect is the kindness comes. Because respect is not just something you say, mm-hmm. you know, you look at them in a certain way, it's also being kind to them. And Allah placed that after worshipping Him as the second major characteristic that the believer should have. When He said that we are commanded to worship Allah and be kind to our parents.
Right. I can tell you, here's a real story. This is from about a week ago. We had tremendous rains in Mali. A young lady walking down the street falls down, and a lot of guys on scooters just whiz past her, showering her with more water, and no one offered a hand of help. Your reaction?
That's a bad sign. That's a bad sign. When the society reaches that stage where you see people in need and just driving by with a blind eye, not having any desire to help, these are bad signs, because of course Islam is completely opposed to that kind of attitude. When the Prophet ﷺ said that a woman who was a prostitute came to a well, got water for herself, got out of the well, saw a dog dying of thirst. Mm-hmm. She went back down into the well, filled water in her shoe, fed the thirsty, dying dog, and Allah put her in paradise for that. So,
alhamdulillah.
I mean, this is the mercy, this is the kindness, this is the care and the concern, you know, which has such great value that Allah overlooked her state of prostitution, having come from that kind of a background, you know. So then how does Allah look then at somebody who would do that, see somebody falling by the wayside and just driving by, splattering water over them without a care?
How do you think we can correct that kind of thing?
Well, this needs to be in the system. It needs to be from childhood. Children have to be raised with that kind of respect, that kind of concern. You know, one of the common factors, I mean, I know from growing up in the West, you know, whenever people would stumble or they would fall, everybody would laugh. Ha 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 ha. Mm-hmm. It would be a big joke. But I realized after becoming a Muslim that this is wrong. So I made sure I taught my children, you don't laugh when somebody hurts themselves. He butts his toe, he's hurting, and you're laughing. It's very common in the West. But from the Islamic perspective, we say, salamatak, you know. Mm-hmm. May Allah, you know, protect you. May it be a source of purification for your sins. You know, that's our attitude. We try to help the person.
Exactly. And this, you just hit upon another word, purification. Muslims are also supposed to be pure and clean and hygienic?
In all aspects, hygienic, from a spiritual perspective as well as from a physical perspective. Because sometimes we get off too much in the physical mm-hmm. and we forget the spiritual aspect. Mm-hmm. Because their purity should be purity of faith, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. That their worship and concept of God should be pure. On a physical aspect, okay, we also wash ourselves for prayer, you know, we wash ourselves when we have sexual relations, we keep ourselves clean as much as possible, you know, we go to lengths that the rest of the world doesn't, you know, everybody else goes to the bathroom and uses toilet paper, we're using water.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's going to clean better than toilet
solvent.
Paper.
Yes.
So we are known for that. Mm-hmm. You know, that is our characteristic.
But at the same time, You're saying that our spirits also have to maintain that hygienic cleanliness.
Yes.
The soul, as it were.
Yes, yes. Purification, that is the purification process. By us seeking God's forgiveness, we purify our repentance, as the Prophet ﷺ had said, mantaba, actually I forgot that. This is not live, is it?
This is recorded, but
okay.
I would rather keep this because that just shows the human qualities in us and that God is forgiving.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Sure, but the dua actually, or the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, I've forgotten, slipped my mind. But the concept is that, you know, whoever repents is like one without sin. Kaman la dhambala. I've forgotten the first part.
Anyway. But that still works. Mm. That still works. In other words, those of us who accept that we do have human qualities, we have our failings, we have our temptations, we have all sorts of forces coming at us. But despite that, if we can remain human, and if we can call ourselves people who are willing to always do better, is that what you're saying, the spirit of what you're saying?
Yes, that's the essence of it. And the hadith that I was searching for, At-ta'ibu min al-dhambi kaman la dhambala. One who repents from sin is like one without sin. So that is the purifying process.
Exactly, exactly. And such simplicity and such attainability is where we are going.
And that's Islam. You know, it doesn't have the complexities of having to believe in a God who became a man and died for your sin, and why did he have to die for our sin? you know, all this other stuff. You know, it's just simple. You do wrong, you turn back to God in repentance, and God can forgive you, no matter how much you have sinned.
And we are from God, and we go back to Him. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, we have to conclude this episode of Witness with Waheed. Hope to meet you very, very soon. Until then, peace be on you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.